ओम श्री साई राम। हरि भजन बिना सुख शांति नहीं, हरि नाम बिना आनंद नहीं, हरि नाम बिना आनंद नहीं, हरि भजन बिना सुख शांति नहीं, जप ध्यान बिना संयोग नहीं, प्रभु दर्श बिना प्रज्ञान नहीं, दया धर्म बिना सत्कर्म नहीं, भगवान बिना कोई अपना नहीं, हरि नाम बिना परमात्मा नहीं, साई नाम बिना परमात्मा नहीं, हरि भजन बिना सुख शांति नहीं। ओम श्री साई राम। द लॉर्ड हिमसेल्फ हैज गिवन हिज परमानेंट एड्रेस टू सेज नारदा। Wherever my devotees sing of me, I install myself. There I install myself. Even the great sage Vyasa, after completing the epic Mahabharata, he was so much troubled mentally and spiritually and emotionally, because he had written one of the greatest epics of one of the greatest wars ever in human history. And war is anything but love. So there was agony. He was feeling restless. Then sage Narada gave him this beautiful advice. Now that you have written about the great divine drama of Mahabharata, where there was a war between good and evil, and that has troubled you because you have gone through the pain of when you are writing something upon some incident, some event, the writer goes through the entire story, the pain and pleasure. At some level he gets affected. Even if he is a sage Vyasa who can detach himself from the entire thing, yet you can't skip absolutely from the side effects of even being a spectator in that sense. The great Sanjay, who was narrating the entire war including the Bhagavad Gita to the blind king through the vision granted to him by Krishna himself, he remained unaffected to some extent. So Narada gave this advice to sage that now you go and write the glory of God, the Bhagavatam. Describe his glory, his leelas, his mahimas. That will bring peace upon you. That will give you the joy, the bliss. Even describing his glory, chanting his name with love, brings the joy, the bliss, the peace. That is why Swami started this bhajana singing. One of the greatest boons of this avatar is, after Guru Nanak Dev Ji Maharaj, to start this community singing, glorifying the Lord. And he chose his angels to sing his glory all over the world. The melody, the bhava raga tala of Sai bhajans is incomparable all over the world. Anybody and everybody can sing his glory wherever you are, whenever you feel like. He has not fixed any timings or any rituals for singing his glory. Yes, when you are singing in the organization, in some official function, Swami says, I come and occupy my seat 10 minutes before the bhajan starts. Look at this humility of this God. I come 10 minutes before and occupy my seat. To feel his presence, you have to do only one thing at physical plane. It is very difficult to feel the divinity, the abstract reality of the Lord. Even the abstract self, our own highest and truest and purest self. That is why I have this vision of this Lord to say that Satya Sai Baba is manifestation of our highest, truest and noblest, purest self. We can see our body self. We work and operate through our mind self. We even operate through our intelligence self. We take so many decisions emotionally from our emotional self. But the highest spiritual self, we cannot even comprehend, because it is beyond our five senses. It is beyond the five elements of earth, water, fire, sound and ether. It is beyond. So how do we comprehend which is beyond our sense of comprehension or perception? The Rishi Munis did tapas for thousands of years to get the glimpse of that reality. Even one glimpse was enough to enlighten their hearts, their minds and their souls. But as I mentioned in my one of the talks, this Kali age is the most blessed ages of all the creation times of human history. Because in this Kali age, the Lord gives the maximum concessions. He himself has decided, as mentioned and by one of the greatest saints of modern India, the hugging mother, Amma of Kerala, Anandamayima. Such avatar does not happen even in 60,000 years. How many centuries, how many yugas? Swami himself declared in Kodaikanal, this avatar does not happen even in yugas. He has been hiding his glory, his powers from us so that we can interact with him, play with him, even argue with him. And sing his glory in his presence and feel comfortable with him in his presence. The Russian scientist, the scientist who has invented the aura, the colors, he declared, and I was present in that meeting in Whitefield, that I am putting my reputation at stake, but I am telling with confidence that such phenomenon is not occurred in human history. I cannot stand in presence of this divine power, because I know, I can see with my open eyes the rays of love and divinity emanating from his body and crossing all the boundaries. The intensity and the scope of this range of these rays is beyond any sensitive instrument that I have created so far, and even I have trained my students to see those rays with open eyes. I myself am teacher of that, but I cannot look at it. They are so intense, so powerful, and so all-pervasive. Such Lord of Love walked on his two legs, interacted with us, taking letters from us, giving us pad namaskars, reacting to our smallest prayers, conversing with us, joking with us, correcting us, cajoling us on the right path. Not one or two, not only students, not only those working officially around him, but millions and millions across the world, across the religion range and nations. Who can do that? Who would want to do that? And bearing all the pain, let me repeat, Christ was crucified only once. Swami declared in one of the Christmas discourses that when Christ directed to a lamb and said, "One who sent me will come again. He will be truth, satya." The Father himself has come, and he was crucified practically every day by the arrogance, by the indifference of his own nears. And Swami told once, Christ at time there was only one Judah. Now there are so many Judas around me. This he declared after the 6th June incident 1993 in Purna Chandra during Guru Purnima discourse. Lord himself declared, doubting Thomases, the Judas. He was crucified every day. Yet he took upon himself all the pain, all the sins, because he was that cosmic authority. He is that cosmic authority, that cosmic energy, the embodiment of compassion without any limits. The ocean might have some limits, but this Lord of compassion has no limits. He accepted everyone with all our wrongs, our can't describe. Such Lord, we hesitate to surrender to him. We all love him. Loving is different from surrendering. You love from your heart. Your ego, your identity is not hurt. On the contrary, sometimes you feel very proud that, oh, I love Satya Sai Baba, I love God. Initial stages, even you feel, oh, Swami loves me, I love Swami, and we feel very happy. But the real test is when you are asked to surrender. Because surrender means you have to surrender your mind, your arrogance, your very identity, the false identity, not the real identity. The lower self has to surrender to the higher self, the highest self. Who benefits? If your tap is connected to the tank, the tap has to be at the lower level. You can't keep your tap at higher level than the tank which supplies you the water and expect water to flow to you. This is surrender. Surrender is not anything. We get fear to surrender. This is called fear of unknown. Why can't we do it spontaneously, effortlessly, joyfully? Because there is in subconscious mind, the fear of unknown. I remember my first encounter with Swami's photograph when father of my friend, took me to Mr. Anandani, Siruman Anandani. And when he showed me that small photograph of Swami, where the pinches of Vibhuti were appearing from inside the glass of the fixed frame, I was reluctant to go and see it. I just wanted to run away from the situation because there was a fear of unknown, whether I am being trapped, I am a scientific minded. I had that same arrogance, same ego. I am a science student. I should not get fooled around. Most of today's modern so-called educated fools, they get fooled around by anything and everybody. In spite of what they claim that they are. But when I came there, what saw me out of his compassion? The master knew that this child has fear of unknown. So when he showed me the photograph of Satya Sai Baba, he telling me, okay, this is Satya Sai Baba. I saw my Krishna. I saw the same form of Krishna on the opening page of my cover page of my Bhagavad Gita, which I used to read every day as homage to my grandfather. I was not interested in dialogue of Arjuna or Krishna. I had no clue about it. We used to believe all these names of God and mythological stories just as fairy tales because we had no first-hand experience, and those telling us also, they were equally blind. Even the people telling those stories, none of them had any direct experience. I mentioned in one of my talks, there was a great saint from Rishikesh, a lady saint, highly spiritual. Her art of oration, she mesmerizing. I mean, the greatest leaders and all, they will come and sit at her feet to listen to her talk, her stories. And next day morning, when Mr. Durgesh Chandra, the director, the vice president of Century, invited me, because she was guest of Century on Birla's, and he was my best friend. So he actually forced me to come. He said, Harish, please come. I want you to assess how great this lady is, the great saint. And when I asked her, she was comparing the powers of Krishna and Rama and trying to prove that Krishna is higher level than Rama. And she was quoting shlokas, page number this book, everything perfect. She has done like a PhD. When I sat in her room, she was talking to her devotees, which immediately put me to this Swami's grace, that this is all the drama is being played. So when she was one-to-one with me, Mr. Durgesh Chandra was there, the doctor who took me there, he was there. I asked her one simple question. Madam, yesterday I heard your talk. I did not tell her, madam, I said Mataji, because she was addressed Mataji. She was young, maybe in 20s, but she was addressed with respect, Mataji. She was a pure noble soul, no doubt on that. We could see the aura. I asked her, you are describing and differentiating between powers of Rama and Krishna, beauty of Rama and Krishna, everything so scientifically, logically, giving reference to scriptures, shlokas and page number. But can I ask you, have you had any direct experience of vision of Rama and Krishna? Because when you make difference between two entities, then you must have witnessed those two entities to say that this is bigger or higher than that. They are not commodities. They are, I mean, according to you, incarnations in human form. And when they were born, of course, you could not be present. So you are describing their qualities as if you know directly. And your talk was very convincing. So you must have had some direct experience of Rama and Krishna. She said, no, this is what our guru taught me. So I am just quoting what my guru has trained me to quote. I speak only what my guruji. I lived in this ashram right from my childhood for so many years. I have been trained in that. Great orator. I said, Manchidi, then at least your guru must have that experience or vision. He must have told you, described his experience, direct experience. She said, no. He also got his all this knowledge from his guru. And I don't think that anybody had seen Rama or Krishna. This is what we memorize the shlokas and all. She was trying to be very open and friendly with me. This is the gift Swami has given me. Even the greatest politician, greatest leaders, greatest businessmen, anyone, they open up friendly with me in very first meeting. This is his grace. They can't bluff around. I said, very good. But let me tell you, with his grace, my Lord hath shown me the real form of Rama as well as Krishna when I was sitting at his feet during bhajans. I saw real physical Rama. I saw real physical Krishna. I found no difference between the aura of glory around them, except that Rama was carrying the bow and arrow and Krishna was carrying the flute. The makeup was different. Everything else was same. And I have seen, witnessed. Then she came down to her level and she said, true brother, we have no authority to compare because we have no direct experience. You are fortunate. We talk because we are trained. It is like our profession. So our human mind is trained to argue, to differentiate. Swami says you find unity in diversity. We find even diversity in unity. This is the nature of mind. So when we want to surrender our mind to God, our ego, mind is ego. Aham akara, ahankara. It is mind will identify itself with our physical existence. And we know if we apply little of our common sense and logic and even scientific knowledge, scientific trained knowledge, what we claim of having acquired of 20 years of doing PhDs and whatnot, what belongs to me cannot be me. This is my body. So I have to be separate from my body to claim that this is my body. Then who am I? My mind. Then who am I? My intelligence. My emotions. My anger. my desire, then who am I? My house, my property, my bank balance, my power, my authority, my position, then who am I? Surrender actually means connecting and enlightening your half-lit mind, your half-lit intelligence, which wrongly identifies itself to your body self, to mindless senses and senseless minds, and gets deluded by it. So we have to connect it. That is connection is surrender. You are connecting your tap in your house to the tank, but to get the water from the tank, you have to be low level. The water flows from high level to low level. Grace flows from top to bottom. Surrendering your mind to your own highest self, there should not be any fear of unknown. God is nothing else but our own highest, truest, noblest self. Be sure of it. To say that we are humans having some God or some soul or spirit inside us is absolutely wrong theory. The fact is, the truth is, we are that highest self, the spiritual being, being given this human body, human mind, human intelligence, human emotions to play our role, assigned to us by our own highest self. I separated myself from myself to love myself, to know myself, to play with myself. It is like one player alone playing chess game, both the sides, black and white both. We have seen great players, they practice, they play, sit on this side and make one move, then they shift the position, come on this side and make the counter move. That is the most entertaining game for them, but because they are playing both the roles. They are their own opponents, they are their own competitors. And that enlightens them. That is the practice they do. They want to compete with their present state of mind. Playing chess is your strategic mind. So you are competing with your own strategic mind and trying to improve upon yourself. That is real competition. You have to improve upon own selves. Dhiyo yohana prachodayat. The purpose of entire sadhana is to invite the effulgence of the highest to enlighten our buddhi. Because our senses are inert, we get attracted by the false perceptions created by our mind. It is like project. We are theater owners, we know how the projector works, how the films work. Upon the screen, the images are created so beautifully with the background music, with the coloring and the acting and performance, that even the most intellectual people get deluded. They laugh when the comedy is going on. They cry when the tragedy is going on. They get tense if the war is going on. Knowing that it is all drama, still we get affected. Otherwise, why would we go to a theater and buy a ticket, spending money and time, energy to watch movie which we don't enjoy? We have to react, and we do react, even the most intelligent so-called, because this is the power of perception. When an ordinary director can create such perception, just imagine with your logical mind, your scientific mind, what can the divine director do? What can the Supreme Master do? Even Narada, I will tell one story of Narada also in my next talk. Beautiful. God deludes, can delude anyone and everyone. Once he deluded Narada and made him marry and have children, and then floods, tsunami, and his all family, everything is gone. He lived in that delusion for years. marrying a beautiful angel created again by God, and he got children out of her, and he got attached to her. He used to go and bring food and water for his family. He enjoyed that for many years. And then once God said, now enough is enough, and one tsunami and everything gone, and he was crying. Then Lord appeared. He said, Narada, what happened to you? You said you are my greatest bhakta, you are a realized soul. Then he got the kick. He can delude anybody. He can enlighten anybody, he can delude anybody. That is his game. And we all are part of his game. Life is a game. Play it. Play it smilingly. You cannot always oblige, but you can at least speak obligingly. Don't take seriously. Take only God seriously in your life. Everything else is like a passing cloud, like a passing scene on the screen. Every scene is projected upon the screen. You touch fire on the screen. You touch water on the screen. You touch hero, heroine, villain, anything and anybody on the screen. You are actually touching the screen. Because actually there is no fire, no floods, no hero, no war. It is all delusion. Maya, maya, maya. Ma, ya. Ma means na. Ya means that which appears to be. Which does not exist but appears to be existing is Maya. And we want to apply our logic, our science, our PhDs on such Maya. How foolish we are. And we resist till last moment to surrender. Arjuna is not commanded by Krishna in the very first chapter. Surrender and shut up. I am telling you. We have come here, you have seen what you wanted to see, don't give this argument, go and wage a war. That is my command. He did not say that. It took 18 chapters. First chapter, questioning Arjuna, and last chapter, surrendering Arjuna. In the last chapter, in the last shloka, what does he say? Now I have understood. Now I am enlightened. And now I am ready to do whatever you command. Cultivate choicelessness. That is surrender. Perform here too. I am ready to do. I am ready to perform. Because now I am enlightened. Now I have understood. It took 18 chapters of questioning Arjuna to become surrendering Arjuna. It is blossoming. Nobody can force. My questioning Arjuna within me started in 71.